Today, I'll be talking about crash data visualization platform that we build using heavily based on open source technologies, but I'll be talking more intensively about Pixi and how we use Pixi and how we solve our business problem using Pixi and Leaflet. So that's a bit of an agenda here. I'll be talking briefly about the Orbica, about our project and challenges we had in this project, the technology stack we followed, and some of the design and features, major milestones that we had in this project. And unfortunately, I won't be able to have a demo because, yeah, my laptop couldn't got well with the screen. But yeah, I have some videos. Probably I'll be able to play them, and so that would give more, should be able to give better insight on how those major features turned out. So Orbica is a solution and a product-based consultancy. We works more mainly in geospatial sector. Most of our solutions and products are amalgamation of GIS, software development, remote sensing, and AI. And my role sits in software development. So, yeah, as he already mentioned, I'm a full-stack developer. Orbica started in 2017, and we started our office in Germany as well in 2018. That's pretty much about Orbica. That's the purpose we live by, to enhance a billion lives through the power of geography. That's how team at the moment looks like. We have two people working from Germany office and rest of the team based in Christchurch. We are a very cross-functional team with geospatial expertise, experts, developers, and IT specialists and marketing and all sorts of things. So for this project, we worked with Catalyst and NZTA, so it was a collaborative project. So, we were a cross-functional team, fully agile. We had people involved from UI UX to testers, developers, to product owner. Bit of a global stats here. So each year, 1.35 million people are killed in roadway crashes. So that's a major number, and especially if you think about most of those crashes are not even recorded, especially like in developing countries, most of the crashes just go without recorded. So that's a major number. Each day 37 people are killed globally in road crashes, and more than half of them are either cyclists, motorcyclists, and pedestrians. So road traffic injuries that led to death are the eighth leading cause of death globally. So talking about New Zealand specifically, in a population of 4.7 million, we have crashes of around 1.5 million. And we have a good, relatively good data that, and we had a lot of scope in terms of playing around with that data and having visualization on that data. Crashes has happened like for numerous number of reasons. Could be speeding, could be drivers unfamiliar with the route, could be weather conditions. So our aim with the tool was to identify those reasons and analyze, and basically help the transport authorities to make New Zealand roads much more safer. So solution that we built was focused on, one, to create easy access to crash database and to have reporting and visualization on those crash data, and second is to help to direct recommendations around road safety funding and road safety programs, and to monitor those things. So that's how the old CAS or the crash analysis system process was. So information was extracted from traffic crash reports, which was then manually fed into data warehouse. So there were a lot of manual data entry that was going behind. People, they were manually geocoding all the crash locations, and that information which goes into data warehouse was a source for the old CAS, which was sitting on top of Excel. So this is how the older version looked like. Your problem with the old CAS is, because this imagine is built 20 years ago, so it's a very old legacy system, and software at that time were niche, but now they are unsupported, unmaintainable, and the people who are, there are very limited vendors who are actually providing an ongoing support, and there were a lot of technical debt in terms of the critical role that it plays. Geospatial information was out of date and it was very difficult to update because the infrastructure and the system libraries were so old. So, and it was very difficult to leverage the advancements that has happened in data visualization now to integrate with the old CAS. Hence, we came up with this old, we came up with this new version of crash analysis system. Some of the guidelines we were given by the client, one is of course, it should be all open source. But, and second, it should support all the existing features that are currently in desktop environment. So the old CAS was actually sitting on a desktop environment. We were asked to make it fully web, and map was a critical part of it. And main idea was to enable the user and user to create spatial and aspatial queries without any SQL knowledge, and it should be cross-platform, and it should support IE, which was a major challenge throughout the project. Some of the obstacles and challenges that we had initially when we started this was number of features. So there were 1.5 million, and we had to make sure that we render those 1.5 million geometries on the browser quite quickly, not making a user to go crazy with the waiting time. So what we used is we used web sockets to do that. We flow the data onto the network, streamlining, and we were displaying the chunks of data as we are receiving. So there was not, so if a user queried a database, and if suppose that query returns 100,000 data set, it will not wait for the 100,000 data set to be returned on the browser and then displayed. So it will fetch every 20,000 records and keep on streaming it on the browser. So we used WebSocket, we used Pixi JS and Leaflet. We used Pixi JS actually two of our major functionalities. One was grouping, which was similar to cluster, but it was based on the grouping of those crashes, was based on some of the rules, some of machine learning algorithms, spatial indexing. And then we worked on collision diagram, which is collision diagram slash crash diagram, which is nothing but a graphical representation of a crash that has happened at a particular location. And so we basically replicated the real world scenario onto a 2D graphic image, and so end user can export that, can analyze that, and yeah, that was a big piece of code we worked on, and we used Pixi to do that. So that's the technology stack. We used Turf, React, Leaflet, Pixi.js, and backend involved PHP, Silverstripe, and Nginx, and yeah. So that's how current CAS looks like. So on the left is a query builder, so you can drag and drop attributes based on which you want to see your crashes on, and you can create your sites, or you can select an area on the map and you can save them, and you can view crashes that has happened only on that particular site. So all the controls that you that's on the map are very customized and catered for based on the business specific requirements. On the left that you see is a custom toolbar, the Leaflet toolbar that we came up with. So idea was that our client wanted to enable the user to create polygons or rectangles and circles, but there were like added functionality onto that, so we couldn't use Leaflet Draw as it is, but we definitely wanted to reuse some of the functionalities that Leaflet Draw had. So what we did is the good part was with Leaflet was that all the classes and all the plugins are extensible. So we used Leaflet class extend, we used Leaflet Draw and Turf to achieve those functionalities, to come up with this standardized Leaflet control from various different existing Leaflet plugins. And we added few of our business specific controls like RSRP or routing. We used Leaflet toolbar. And we extended that to come up with a customized toolbar. So main things, or how we did it is we extended leaflet toolbar, and we overwrite add toolbar and remove toolbar. Add toolbar was where all the magic was happened. That's the meta where we initialize the mode handler. When we talk about initializing mode handler, what it does is it finds out which menu item is clicked on the toolbar, based on which it attaches the handler, and that handler identifies, okay, if a user has clicked circle, what slide out menu I should display, what events I should display along with those DOM elements and things like that. So we actually had to put in very less effort in terms of reusing the existing plugins, and it was easier for us to add business specific functionalities on top of existing controls. So how can I play this? Yeah, I see. Yes. Oh. It's just coming out.
It's just, I don't think it recognizes it as a video.
Okay, so that's again a turn off here. I wanted to show the toolbar in action. Probably people who are interested, I might show it after this talk. Next is Pixi. Pixi is basically a rendering library, to a 2D graphic rendering library. It allows user to create a rich interactive graphic experience, supports cross-platform, works on all major browsers currently we have, works on mobile, works on desktop. We used Pixi for its simplicity and the amount of complications that you can get over with it. You don't have to get into WebGL APIs deeply, and you can easily do stuff with Pixi, which is like a wrapper around WebGL library. It is performance-wise, it is fast, and that was one of our major concern, was to render all those graphics on the browser, and should be fast enough. There's a feature called smart batching, which comes out of box with PixiGL. What it does, it groups, it basically draws all those graphics by grouping the objects using their merged geometries. So that reduces the number of draw calls and uploads to the GPU. Another thing is it uses GPU instead of CPU, so which is again makes the performance overall faster. Again, I don't think I'll be able to show PixiJS, but you can definitely go to PixiJS IO documentation, and you can have a look of the demos. They are pretty impressive in terms of how many graphics there you can render in without much glitches on the browser. And considering the browser memory space is very limited, so it works out well for us at least. So we worked on we used Pixi on two major features. One is grouping. Grouping, the idea here was to replicate cluster behavior, but it was based on some business specific logic. We used spatial indexing, and we used clustering algorithm to generate all these markers and groups. So bottom right, if you see, is zoomed out level. So we have these many crashes, and those colorings are based on the severity of the crash, which can be fatal, can be minor or serious, So top right, if you see, is our markers and groups, and if you click on a marker, we have to spiderify or show a spiral based on if the crashes are more than 8 or less than 8 at that particular location. So all of that. Behavior-wise, it was very similar to cluster, the prune cluster, but the underlying code that we've written is based in Pixi, and we use Leaflet Pixi overlay library, which integrates Pixi with Leaflet. So it add as a layer onto the map, and you just deal with that layer. 1.2 keep keep in mind when we are working with any library like Pixi or any graphic library is to manage the WebGL render memory leak. So we made sure that we create one renderer which contains one container and all our graphics sits inside that container, and making sure each time we run a query, we clear our renderer and our container so that our browser doesn't crash. Another functionality that we use Pixi in is a crash diagram. So we use spatial indexing here as well. We use quad tree and we use rule-based placement of Pixi graphics. All this that you see, basically the red line that you see is a road, and we have slight, they're very coming across as really light, but those are road names, and then these are bubbles which are showing, which are, these are numbers are crash IDs, and they have some icons beside these IDs. Those are basically whether it was fatal or was serious, then whether pedestrian was involved and things like that. So we basically replicated what the area selected onto the map. We generated that area, mapped those lat longs to canvas X and Y, and created those crashes. Those crash placements was a bit of a challenge because we wanted to ensure that we generate the collision diagram automatically on the fly, and those should not overlap each other. There was some collision detection algorithm behind the scene that we made sure that all the bubbles are displayed with minimum collision, and we were handling scale change on the diagram, so user can zoom in, zoom out on the diagram. All these bubbles that you see are draggable, droppable, so they can drag and drop, change the position, and export that diagram as a report. So that's how, again, this was actually a video, but I don't think it's, I'll be able to show that, but. So that's how map results look like on the map. It's complete data set on the map. Few more screenshots of the application. There's some reports, some charts. That's how collision diagram looks like. Some more screenshots. Thank you.
Hi, I'm at MOT and actually used the application you developed. I just had a question about the crash diagram, because I don't think I've used that one. When they've got the movements of the various vehicles and entities involved with the crash, do you have anything that transposes that on the map? So for example, the direction in which one of the vehicles was coming in, and you can actually see that as a as an arrow on overlaid on the roads, or is it just the bubbles?
Yeah, so we had movement codes which identify, there are like over 23 to 25 movement codes, and which identifies the movement of the vehicle, the direction of the road, and all sorts of things. So we were displaying those information when we click on any marker, which is like a crash, and we were showing that as well in collision diagram as well. So all those bubbles which has SVG in it, so the small diagram that you see inside those bubbles are actually movement code, and that identifies what was the direction of the vehicle, what was the direction of the road. So there is some coding behind the scene. Yeah.
Cool. I have a question. So what struck me watching this presentation is how sensitive a lot of this data is, in particular when we look at things like drunk driving. And for instance, I remember when the NZTA published a lot of this data publicly, and I looked at a crash that had happened near my house, and it turned out that a friend of mine actually knew the driver of that car. And what I discovered by looking at this data set was that they were drunk, and their person didn't know that. So obviously there's a lot of concern about the privacy of this information, so I understand this is an internal tool?
Yes, so it's not a public tool. It's mm-hmm. being used by NZTA and some of the internal roading engineering industries and transport authorities, so it's not public.
But privacy is still an issue, even with the internal use. I mean, the NZTA is quite a large organization.
Yeah, if it's internal, we have specific credentials given to special people who can access the system. So that way, we are keeping the system secure. Yep.
Any more questions?
Yeah, hi, I'm Chris. I'm from Canberra, from the ACT, where all traffic accidents are to be reported. I was just wondering whether, or who puts the new data in for accidents? Is it the police?
Can you please repeat, sorry?
The recording of the traffic accidents, is that through the activity or the attendance of the police?
So if any crashes happens, it's police who was given a hand device, and there's one part, another part of this project was where police can fed that information directly to the system. So those crash information is fed automatically to the database from the police end, and then that information is extracted at the app level.
Cool. So thank you, Banika. So we'll give her a round of applause for a brilliant presentation.